Okay, everyone, I think we're ready to start back up. Just give a few people some time to get across the hall. If you haven't been across the hall to see Big Blue Button, and who else is over there? Ian? Who else is over across the Big Blue Button?
No.
Okay, so this is the last panel of the day. Again, I'm very excited by the, you know, I don't want to say every panel's been better than the next, because that means the first panel, you know, and Jim wasn't great, and they indeed were. I can't believe we've been here for as long as we have. The time has flown by, and I hope you all are enjoying the panelists and the discussions as much as I am. And again, the goal is really to provide an opportunity for folks working in different areas to learn from one another and be able to help grow their own programs and find success. And so this panel is, I think, we've talked about a lot of what has happened, how projects got started, commonalities between projects. And now, you know, this particular panel is very interesting on sort of what Martin was talking about before, about sustainability, growing community, and so on. So I think this will be a nice capstone to the day with some take-home messages that everyone can leave with to help grow their projects and contribute and participate in different ways. We're also very happy to have a long time, I'm proud to say he's a friend, that former SUNY colleague for many years, Michael Feldstein, and I'm sure most of you know him as the prolific blogger. But the illiterate family of EdTech, it's an empire it's growing into. once you offer toilet services, and you'd be able to do it all. But Michael Feldstein will be moderating, and I'll let him introduce the panel. Once again, thank you everyone for coming. Thank you to Apereo and also for Red Hat for their sponsorship. And now I give you Michael.
Thank you, Patrick, and thank you all for hanging in there for the very last session of the day before you go off for dinner and receptions and all that fun stuff. By way of introduction to the panel, I was reflecting earlier in the day on a comment an audience member made on the panel, the last panel before lunch, about, there was this interesting back and forth with Nicole about the state of nature, and well, what about this innovation of actually creating scarcity through licensing and allowing creators to be compensated, and wasn't that, you know, doesn't that have some value? And what that really brought home to me is that social work organizations are human inventions. We don't think about them that way, but they really are. And we are endlessly innovating them. You know, I hunt, you gather, I wash, you dry, I rob the bank, you drive the getaway car, right? Sort of the history of humanity and the growth of the civilization is that we get more and more creative and elaborate in how we build these work organizational structures, and really the entire profession and field of law is a way of codifying and providing some regulation and scale to these human inventions of work organization that we're always coming up with. It, law is one giant hack of human civilization. I mean that word hack with both the positive and negative connotations, and I would add that many lawyers themselves are hacks. So there are really two different ways that these things can evolve, right? I mean, there's very natural, when you start with a situation where I bring the chocolate, you bring the peanut butter, right? for that to evolve into, well, I'm the chocolate guy. You want chocolate? You got to come to me. You think you're going to sell chocolate on my corner? Sorry, you're going to have to find your own corner, right? That system works, right? A lot of civilization has been built on that. There's a different way of thinking about it, which is, I got a lot of chocolate. I got more chocolate I can eat. Why don't we all get together? I'm going to bring some chocolate. Does anyone have some peanut butter they can bring? And when we talk about this amorphous thing that we call openness in all its various, you know, flavors, I find it impossible to really articulate what it is that we mean other than this value, the feeling that you get of, you know what, I don't want to charge for my chocolate. I just want to have a potluck. I'm going to invite people over and hopefully someone will bring peanut butter. And that's fine for a one-night thing, but like if you really need at that point to supply the world with Reese's peanut butter cups, then you need a little bit more of a strategy, right? And the strategy is different. If it's I bring the chocolate and you bring the peanut butter, the strategy for keeping that relationship going is very different than I bring the cello and you bring the oboe, or I bring knowledge of how to make canoes and you bring knowledge of how to make paddles. So I'm very pleased to have four panelists that are bringing together people for really very different purposes with very different organizational structures, but each in its own way open. And so we're going to talk today about their challenges and their innovations in their organizations to keep these potluck parties going. And so one of the things that I want to do in that spirit of innovation, rather than having me introduce each one of them, I think it's important for you to hear from each of them how they characterize what it is that they're doing. So I'm going to ask each of you, starting with Ian, just to tell us a little bit about your organization. What is this potluck party that people are coming to in your organization? What are they trying to accomplish? And what are you trying on a very high level to convince them to do?
Produce infinitely replicable chocolate. But the serious answer, I mean, I took Jim Whitehurst's comment this morning about open source software communities being a licensing construct and a set of social norms, which I think a very pithy and accurate description. I just want to say a little bit about a foundation, our foundation, the Apereo Foundation, in setting those norms. So we're a multidimensional. We're a membership organization that consists of higher education institutions and now other education institutions worldwide, with a smaller group of commercial partners, a smaller commercial ecosystem around our software. We're also very much a partnership organization. We consciously seek out partnerships, either on a national and regional basis. We have a very close partnership with the ASAP Portai Consortium of 75 universities in France, or on a specialist knowledge basis, and we have an informal but developing partnership with Solar around learning analytics research and our learning analytics research work. We have multiple dimensions inside of the Apereo Foundation also. You know, we have software communities, what people call projects. Some of those you will have heard of, like Sakai or UPortal, or if you're an infrastructure person, CAS, and a whole bunch of other stuff. And we have regional and national groupings. So I mean, what's the role of a foundation in this context and in this multidimensionality? Well, I mean, I like to look on the foundation as a lens to focus community experience and resource, and it's a lens that needs constant regrinding and adjustment. In higher ed, and one of the problems we face in higher ed, we live in pyramids. We saw Jim present a couple of pyramids this morning, one the right way up and one upside down from our perspective. We are not that kind of organization. We deliberately set out not to be pyramidal, but to be collegiate. So we exist to empower and engage our members. That only works by developing self-activity. And it only works by devolving the right power to the communities which we're made up from. You know, we need to create the conditions for their success. We do the things collectively as a foundation that they do less well. We leave them to the direction of their own activity almost entirely, because they're closer to the problem space. So really our role is exactly to perform those tasks that aren't performed better by our member organizations, including our software communities and our institutions. And that's a lot of stuff that sounds desperately tedious, like licensing and finance where it's necessary, and admin and community infrastructure like these gatherings we have this week. And all of that is a crucial bit of glue and a framework that enables our software communities and other communities to be more effective by focusing on what they need to focus on.
Great. My name's Deb Nicholson, and I work at the Open Invention Network as the Director of Community Outreach. We're a 10-year-old defensive patent pool for Linux and GNU and Android and a ton of other open source projects and tools. We bring all these people to the table together to collaborate, because otherwise they have to be always looking over their shoulder when they make software together that one or the other of them will bring a patent lawsuit. Even if you don't pay attention to it on a day-by-day basis like I do, you must have noticed there's a lot of patent suits, and we keep bringing them, and they're very expensive. They have large, large numbers that sound like endowments or fortunes, lottery winnings. So there's a lot to be gained there, but there's a lot to be lost there. So with that amount of risk, it makes it really hard to collaborate on software if you are always worried that your partners have the potential to stab you in the back and drag you into court. So our mindset is that openness needs trust, it needs transparency, and it needs a level playing field. And if it needs to be contractually obligated, then so be it. And then we find that once people get in, they've signed the agreement to not sue each other for patent infringement, they kind of like, maybe sort of mentally take off their shoes and relax a little bit, and they feel better about collaborating together. So we work really hard to create a space where everybody feels like, oh, this isn't a dangerous place. This is a welcoming place, and it's a place where we can collaborate.
Very good. Beth.
So I think you already know what I do, but just the sort of big mission picture is to basically to make the history of the things that human beings create a lot more engaging than, did anyone read Jamson or Gardner in college, maybe? Anyway, a lot more interesting than the textbook, a lot more meaningful and engaging, and also to get faculty to not put things in LMSs, but instead to expose their expertise. So I think that might be an interesting thing to talk about.
And Beth, could you just say a moment about, you talked a little bit about it in your last talk, but just to remind us, like, who are you trying to get to come and collaborate?
So anyone who is an art historian or in an allied field, so archaeology, anthropology, conservation, things like that. So anyone with real deep expertise in any of those academic areas, material technology, stuff like that.
Great. Mary Lou.
Hi, I'm Mary Lou Forward. I'm the director of the Open Education Consortium. We were the Open Courseware Consortium until 2014, and we changed our name when we changed our focus to be larger than just the courseware. So we exist to promote open education around the world. We have about 300 university members and affiliated organizations who are all committed to the principles of openness and committed to figuring out how the next generation of learners are going to experience things in an open environment. So we try to bring people together. We try to create community. We create opportunities for people to talk and to participate. We try to highlight activities that are happening in different parts of the world. So someone in Nigeria knows what's happening in Texas, and Indonesia knows what's happening in the Netherlands, so that in the small resource-strapped areas of openness at universities, people can collaborate with each other and take advantage of their own principles across great distances.
Right. So what's interesting here is that you the collaborators that you all have to work with and the commitments that you're asking for are very different. Trying to get a large corporation to share a patent is, I can only imagine, extremely challenging. But it's a very different kind of challenging than, say, getting a university to contribute a part-time developer to an open-source project, or a time-strapped faculty member to contribute to the creation and maintenance of open courseware or open educational resources. I want to start with sort of an easy... Obviously, if each of you has lasted in your job, I assume, more than 6 months, which means that at some point there was a moment when you saw something succeed. Somebody new who came in, or somebody that really stepped up their game, that was, or some trick to get people involved that was inspiring to you, that made you feel like, well, this is just crazy enough to work. So I'd like for each of you to tell me a story about that moment when you saw a member get hooked on contribution. Why don't we start with you, Beth?
Well, the story that comes to mind is Trello, the project management software Trello. Some folks at Khan Academy were using it to just do project management, but we... decided to try to use it to do a forward-facing board that had all of the things that we were looking for contributions for. So on our site for years, we had, are you an art historian? Are you a curator? Are you an archaeologist? Please contribute. You know, and they would trickle in, you know, and it was really slow. The second we put up the Trello board and a sort of call for contributions, which we had done before, but in conjunction with the Trello board, it was like magic. You know, and now we have more than 200 contributors. And so what fascinates me about this is, what is it about the interface of the Trello board that made... So the only thing that I can think of is that, sort of like going to the teller at the bank, where you don't have to interface with a person, right? You'd rather go and just get money out and put a deposit in and not talk to anybody. I think there's something about the Trello board where a faculty member can just go, claim a card, put a due date that works for them. They can change the due date if they want to. They don't have to talk to me. They don't have to get permission. They don't have to email me, at least once they're in the Trello board. And so I think that that was the magic. But on the other hand, it's very hard to know. I mean, someone else today was talking about Slack. So sometimes I think there's something about these interfaces that help collaboration, where other very similar products that are meant to do the same thing, project management, or, you know, chat like Slack, somehow the design of it, or it's something quirky about it, really does work where others have failed before.
So when you say, Beth, that they don't have to interface with people, I mean, how is that Trello board structured? How do I come into, I don't want to get into the minutia, but
yeah.
Like I've certainly been involved in projects where I walk in and I see there are all these people who know so much, and I feel like I know nothing, and I have nothing to contribute. How is that Trello board set up so that I, when I come in for the first time, have a sense of where I belong on
that? That's a great question, Michael. The Trello board is organized by expertise, area of expertise. So anyone who's an art historian or an archaeologist or in something like that will look at the Trello board columns and be able to sort of see, oh, I do South Asia, and I'm going to look at this column. I think they feel at home. And I think the other thing that happens with the Trello board is that they find this stuff that's their stuff. But they see other, because, you know, when you claim something on the Trello board, when you claim a card as yours, as something you're going to work on, and put a due date, it puts a little picture of you on the card. And so I think immediately there started to be a sense, even though no one was actually talking to one another, a sense of a virtual community. Oh, you know, this person I went to graduate school claimed this sculpture. I'm going to claim this painting that's related. So a little bit even of competition over territory. I think may have played a part in it.
Nothing gets academics going than showing that
competition.
That their colleagues are not as smart as they are. Yeah. Now, Mary Lou, you are dealing with a somewhat similar constituency, if I understand your project correctly. How about you? What is that thing that you saw that pulled people in?
Sure. So there's two things that I just want to mention. One is more at the how the field became easier to talk about and why the field perhaps is starting to take off. And another is more personal about a faculty. So in the field, one of the things that we had a lot of pushback in open education, particularly around open educational resources at the beginning, was the quality question, right? These just, they're not peer reviewed or they're not as good as other things. We now are at the point where we have some fantastic research groups, including the OER Research Hub in the UK and the Open Education Research Group in Utah, who now have done mega reviews of, I think the last one was 138 peer reviewed studies about the outcomes of classes that use open educational resources versus those that use traditional paid materials. And what they found in 138 peer-reviewed studies is there's no difference. There's either no difference or the group that's using open education resources are doing slightly better. So the quality question is done, and we think we can safely say that we're over that, and that allows the field then to kind of put that behind us and move forward. And so it's much easier now to talk to faculty and administrators about questions of quality because we have the research data to back that up. And then to answer that as more maybe a personal spark question, we work a lot with faculty about, you know, why should I use open education? Why should I embrace these principles? And every time you ask them, why are you an educator? They never talk about the materials. They never talk about the content. That's not what's important. What is important is making that connection to help the students really spark and say, I get it, and get excited. And so we have a wonderful professor of French who we've been working with for a couple of years at the University of New Hampshire. And at first, she did just a straight substitution of an open textbook for her closed textbook. But she was always kind of frustrated with the textbook. The thing that open allowed her to do was to say, okay, you know, go home and practice, but when you're practicing these conversations, I want you to write examples of the conversation, and I'm going to use them in the next class. So the students then became co-creators of the materials that were used for future classes. And because of that, they wanted to be involved in those future classes, and there's a whole volunteer student group around tutoring students who are taking French. Her class has become extremely popular because the students are so engaged, and she's pretty much let go of the content. She's pretty much turned the content over to the students. Obviously, she lends her expertise. She facilitates that process, but the students own it. And that has made a huge difference. And now, I was just at the University of New Hampshire last week, four of her colleagues are embracing open educational projects this year because of what they've seen her do. And that kind of small viral takeoff, because it's effective, is what really, I think, is driving the movement.
Hmm. Now, Ian, you have a much more complex, layered set of constituencies with different projects, some engaging with very different stakeholder groups. So just pick one. Tell me a success story.
Well, I mean, I was going to answer your original question with, I would have difficulty picking from a huge number of examples of individual innovation within our community. The thing that really energizes and excites me about the job that I do are always the community gatherings. Mm. And we have a very mixed community of deeply technical people, learning technologists, faculty, although too few of them, we need to encourage more. But it's those events and work we do to recognize some of the individuals within our community, work like our teaching awards, which have been for years, the Sakai Teaching Within Innovation, teaching, Twizia, Teaching Innovation with Sakai. We've changed that to be an Apereo-wide thing. We've drawn some other communities inside Apereo into those awards. And you just see fantastic examples of how the software that our communities create affect individual courses, students, and staff in institutions. And that really is the big motivator for me. And I guess if I would pick one thing from the air, we have a project which is called Karuta, because many of our projects have Japanese names, and it's a collaboration between institutions to create a next generation portfolio environment. It's a project which was born within Apereo, if you like. It's not been formed elsewhere and come in. It's a partnership of HSM Montreal, a business school, a university in France, Grenoble, Kyoto University, and a very small US-based company. Now, I'm pretty sure those people would not have found each other to make that collaboration without Apereo. Hmm. And that's the kind of thing that floats my boat.
So in what I hear is, as one ingredient in the secret sauce, is getting everyone together in a room, really.
Yeah, and continuing the collaboration beyond that. But right, yeah, it's really energizing a community to collaborate, to solve problems that they face.
Helping people find each other, though.
That's right.
Now, Deb, from our previous conversations, I know you've got some side projects that are also really interesting, so I don't want to limit you, but I admit that I am very curious about how you get these companies to jump in on this patent. And I'm sure there are very complex debates that go on inside the companies, some of which are utilitarian and some of which are a little bit more about principle and maybe instinct.
It's one of the challenges we face is that most of the companies we talk to, their counsel is not particularly familiar with the specifics of open source licensing or have never heard of a defensive patent pool. So I had a colleague, when I started at the Open Invention Network, my colleagues would always talk to people like, well, you should join because you want to make sure you don't get sued by the companies that are already in here. And they were really trying to use fear as a motivator. And so I'd go to these events, you know, again, everybody gets really excited when they're out in public and together and talking about what they do. And people were like, oh yeah, we're really excited. We have this new project. It's a startup. We're gonna do it open source. It's gonna be awesome. You know, and then you throw this like, oh, what if you get sued? And they're like, I don't know. It's probably, they're not ready to think about that yet. But so when I started asking people like, well, what kind of company do you want to be in this space? Do you want to be the company that people are like, oh, make sure you don't talk to those folks because they'll sue your butt for patent infringement if they get wind of what you're doing? And they're like, oh, no, we don't want to be that. We want to be, you know, here all kumbaya with the rest of you and sharing the source code and, doing better on not having to reinvent the wheel on boring stuff or stuff that's already been written that we don't need to make our own database. We don't need to make our own text editing. Like we can take that from the community and then just work on the little piece that we're really interested in, which is fantastic because, I mean, who doesn't want to offload the stuff that's already been done and get right to work on the new problems? So when I asked them sort of like aspirationally, who do you want to be? What do you want to be in the space? It really changed from being like, oh, you don't want these companies to sue you, to like, yeah, okay, I'll pass it to our lawyers maybe. To like, oh yeah, you're right. We want everyone to love us and, you know, want to contribute to our community and be part of what we're working on. And we want to have great relationships with the people we collaborate with.
Now, once you've got them to contribute their patents, are they done? Is that the end of it? Or is there an ongoing, because with software and content, you can talk about maintenance. Like, what is the maintenance in your world?
So
or is there?
So there's kind of two things. For the maintenance, it's two things. We talk to people about doing defensive publications, which is adding to the U.S. Patent and Trade Office's store of prior art to keep that current with the current technology. So, along with that, as long as keeping current, is that we have to constantly tinker with the definition of what we all agree to is our non-aggression area. Because technology changes. Like when we started, it was like, all right, it's gonna be the GNU and Linux and Android. And now it's like, all right, not are we gonna do the cloud, but how much of the tooling and stuff that we run the cloud on is gonna be included.
Okay.
It's a lot. So.
Yeah. So there are two directions I wanna cover. One is continuing down that path of, okay, you've got someone to participate, now what? But before we get there, I want to step back because a couple of you have talked a little bit about in the context of a question about contributing, you've talked about adoption. And so I'd like to hear from each of you about the degree to which and the sense in which adoption is contributing in your world, and how one slides into the to other kinds of contributions. So who'd like to start?
I'm not sure I understand the question.
Yeah. So if I'm an art history professor, and I start using smart history resources in my class.
So user versus builder.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Yeah. First of all, does just adopting that, do you consider me a contributor to smart history? What is the minimal thing I need to do in order for you to think of me as a contributor?
Write a 1,000-word essay.
Okay. All right. So for you, it's a 1,000-word essay.
Or talk to me in a conversation about a work of art that I can make a video from.
Answer okay. a question about one piece of our software on the list.
Or participate on the Khan Academy platform answering student questions.
Okay. I want you to repeat what you just said closer to the microphone, and then I want you to repeat what you just said.
Answer a question about some of our software on the list. I mean, contribution goes from that. We have people who write documentation. We have a group of people in our community who've come together this year to actually help market open source software produced by Apereo. You know, there are all kinds of levels of contribution other than writing code, and we need to expose all of those ways of contributing to the broadest possible audience. I mean, I look on adoption as a beginning of wisdom.
Yeah.
You know, typically if you adopt our software, you want to do something innovative with it. Otherwise, you're just going to go and buy some commercial proprietary off-the-shelf thing. And if you want to innovate, when you begin to innovate and make that innovation into a contribution, you know, that's the kind of flow. And we know full well, I mean, without wanting to labor it, if you innovate around open software and don't contribute it back, you carry the burden yourself. You've got a fork, and you're going to just maintain that. So, you know, there's a lot of education involved in this. There's a lot of exposure to old ideas. And there are some brand new good ideas, like our marketing group, coming in.
Let's get back to that in a few minutes. Any more comments about the minimum amount, the minimum contribution to be a contributor?
So for more broadly speaking, in the free and open source software community, just using the software, we might not even know that you're doing that. We don't begrudge you that. It's fine. It's like, first time you come over for dinner, we're not going to make you wash the dishes. But if you keep coming over, then we're going to be like, hey, it's your turn. We notice. And so, you know, it takes some folks longer than others. But adoption, for us, we really consider that step one. And then you're not done. Come on, keep going.
Yeah, I think for us, open education is really about, it's about access, it's about equity, and it's about opportunity. So adoption, if that drives those goals, beautiful. And we have to have people who adopt it, otherwise, you know, who needs 7,000 biology courses out there? We want people to adopt it and adapt it and to fork it and to do what they want with it, because the ultimate goal is to create opportunities with education and to give people what they need. And they don't need necessarily everybody to produce content. They need people to be innovative with that content.
Oh, I need a lot more people to produce content. A lot.
Okay. So we definitely have some differences of, let's say, threshold. So let me ask a slightly different question. When you think about the population of your communities, respective communities, when do you think they start thinking of themselves as contributors? Is it the same threshold as yours?
You know, I think it's smart history, it's really, it's, you know, for example, we have one contributing editor who's contributed a ton of stuff, And it's because she teaches Latin American art, colonial Latin American art, and the textbooks stink. I was going to use another word, but I didn't. And so she just saw Smarthistory and she thought, wow, a free platform. I could write my own textbook and they'll distribute it and edit it for me. And I think that happens to, it was true for our Africanist, who also didn't like the content on the Art of Africa and thought about customizing it and being able to write her own textbook and distribute it. But for the majority of faculty, adopting it, who knows, they're maybe using it in clever ways. I hope they are. But not enough people are putting the content outside of the LMS. For me, not enough people with a lot, you know, there are not that many people who do the Art of Africa. There's a very small number of art historians who do that. And I need more of those art historians to help contribute to the content on the platform.
Is it outside the LMS that you care about or outside the login?
Outside the login.
Okay. Now, Ian, you said if somebody contributes, answers a question on a discussion board about the software that you consider them a contributor. Do you think that is understood by the person, is felt by the person making the contribution at the time? And do you, as an organization, what do you do as an organization to underline and say, hey, that's a contribution?
Well, we're kind of multi-layered, as you might have gathered. We have, as everybody who produces open source software does, vastly more people and institutions who use our software than who are actually foundation members. So it's important to make that kind of distinction. Our close network, you know, together with our French colleagues, we're around 150 institutions worldwide. We have 10 projects, software communities have graduated in incubation and 7 in incubation at the moment. I'm not sure whether that person who writes the email believes that they're making a contribution, but I want our community to learn to value that contribution and reinforce it. Mm-hmm. And one of the problems we have, quite frankly, I think, is that I genuinely do think that, and this is perhaps slightly higher ed specific, that some institutions that adopt our software believe that they've established some kind of relationship with a vendor, and they carry. Sorry, I'll lean forward. They carry all kinds of expectations into that relationship. And that's really a long haul education and experience job to break down.
So Mary Lou, you talked about how it's fine with you to have people who they adopt. Like adoption is good, right? If that's where you stop, that's okay with us. We definitely want people to be writing and editing and all of that, but we also want people to be adopting. What is your, and I understand also that people can adopt and you will never know, right? Mm-hmm. What is the relationship that you try to have with adopters? Like what is, how are they positioned in your community?
So it's interesting because we definitely still have people who adopt openly licensed open educational resources and call it stealing. They say, I've stolen this resource. And we, no matter how often we try to explain, you're not stealing, this is what we want you to do, there still is this kind of idea that I've gone rogue and I've stolen this resource. At the same time, they have absolutely no problems doing a screenshot of anything on the internet and putting that up there. we are still fighting that quite a lot. But, you know, we do try to highlight the adopters as much as possible because in some ways it's a little bit like, I don't want to use a drug analogy, so let's use sugar. It's a little bit like your first spoonful of sugar, right? You can use this, you see it's easy, then maybe I want to try a milkshake. So then they are not just adopting, but now they're beginning to do more like what I talked about with the French professor who's really doing some pretty innovative, creative co-creation of materials with her students. So adoption is absolutely, it can be an end point, but it can also be a first point. So we try very hard to highlight those people and also to show that when you do adopt, it's not stealing, it's also not bad. And I think this morning we heard a little bit about academic culture and the idea if I didn't invent it or I didn't write it, then I'm not doing my job or I'm not a real whatever, a real expert. We're really trying to combat that because we had a question about how, you know, how do you value people for creating content? Well, if you're a creative person and you're probably starting with someone else's content anyway, whether that's a research article you read or something else, but you're relying on other people's content. And we have this tradition in research where it's great to build on other people's research, but on the education side of the house, it's not great to build on other people's, say, PowerPoint presentations. And that's just a fallacy. That's something that we're trying really hard to argue against.
Now, Deb, it feels to me as a non-legal person, but somebody who has followed educational patents a little bit, trying to convince a company to contribute a patent is kind of an everybody in the pool moment. It's not you're in or you're out, right?
Yeah.
Am I wrong about that? Is there a gentle slope you can build?
The Open Invention Network license, you either sign it or you don't. It's not, you can't be like, how about you guys don't sue us for a while and then we'll think about not suing you next year? That doesn't work. It has to be everybody on the even playing field. It is difficult to make that case for people who are really used to seeing patent assertion as like a column on their budget and things like that. And so the earlier we can get to companies and kind of talk them off that ledge is like, you know, like, hey, who do you want to be when you grow up? Like a intellectual ventures patent troll or like someone who's like on the cover of Wired because you made awesome software. And they're like, all right, yeah, okay, I see that. But it's tricky because we have a lot of momentum towards using it for assertion, and it really steals focus, especially for smaller companies, to spend a lot of their energy figuring out who they could sue instead of figuring out how to build software. But it also steals a lot of focus to get sued, so that's why it's got to be all in or all out.
Yeah, it's a really it's interesting to me that the utilitarian argument of you don't want to be sued carries less weight than the values argument of, or the, maybe you could call it
the
branding,
aspirational.
But aspirational are, that's the right.
I think it's something about the really optimistic type of person who's attracted to building something abstract in the world that's gonna make it better or more useful or more efficient. Like almost nobody believes that they're going to get a letter until it arrives. Mm-hmm. So, you know, like people would always ask me like, oh, or am I making software that is infringing a patent? And I say, yes. And they're like, wait, I didn't tell you what kind of software I was making. Yeah. I'm like, oh, sure, you can tell me, but the answer will still be yes. Because that's the number of software patents that are on the books. Like no matter what you're doing, it's probably infringing a patent.
Wow.
So it's not really, occasionally people would float to me like, well, I have this other idea about not getting sued for patent infringement, and it's called not making any money. And I'm like, yeah, that could work, but I don't know what are you trying to accomplish?
So, that's struck me momentarily speechless.
Yeah, there's a lot of thinking outside the box in the software field.
That's really done.
Not easy. No, but I want to talk a little bit about this this sort of aspirational versus utilitarian motivation, because you all deal with both at the beginning the contribution, but also at some point there's just some hard, grinding, thankless work, committee work, code maintenance, you know, copy editing, whatever it is that people commit to, and it gets larger and larger as their lives get more and more complicated, or as their business arrangements get more and more complicated. Like, how do you see that those two motivations playing out in your respective worlds, as you see the the community members move along this path of standing on the edge and watching into, you know, full-on commitment? How does it work in each of your worlds?
Well, I guess in my world, it starts with someone, usually who has the aspirational aspect, finding a problem, a real problem, in their institution, and looking in the right place for the solution, the right place being an open community, rather than simply going to somebody's product catalog. And kind of that's the hinge, that small group of people, and I suspect rather many of them from some institutions are present in the room, that small group of people are the critical group of people in making what we do work collectively.
So when you talk about a small group of people, so this isn't probably, most of the time, an individual contributor. Rather, this is a departmental there's some stakeholder who has the some weight within the institution or some group of stakeholders to say, we, as you know, the IT department of university of wherever, need to solve this problem together. Is that right, or
that's,
is it?
That's probably where it starts. Although it might not be the IT department.
Sure.
But that's probably where it starts. And then it's the more aspirational or visionary people within that group who join the dots between the problem and the solution. But I mean, I wouldn't want you to go away with the idea that, you know, everything that is committed to Apereo, whether it be documentation or code or whatever, is all the result of institutional investment. We have many, many, many volunteers who contribute way above and beyond their job, and indeed in some cases people who've moved from jobs in higher ed who still make contributions. So I wouldn't want to leave that impression. It's a very, very mixed contribution model.
So almost by definition, those people, those individuals who are contributing beyond their job, that is aspirational in a sense. There may be some utilitarianism for them in the sense that it looks good on their CV and so on and so forth. But that is it fair to say that feels like it's a values thing? It's a passion thing.
Yeah, it's a values thing, and it's a feeling part of a broader community.
Sure.
And contributing to that community thing. Really, I mean, that if you asked many of the people,
yeah,
who work on our software communities, who work on our projects and our releases, that's the kind of thing they're likely to say.
Now, what about at the institutional level? I mean, you have leaders who are coming in, and on the one hand, they may have, you know, the same aspirations and passions as the individual contributors. On the other hand, they have accountability to other, to you know, for budget, for you know, various responsibilities that are in their job description for their entire department. How does that mix play out? And I know there's no one answer, but.
No, I mean, the one common element would be usually that if we were approached by people in a particular school around a particular piece of software, that software community itself would kind of share what worked for them.
Yeah.
What convinced their boss. Mm-hmm. And the contexts are all different. We all know every higher education institution is different. But there's enough commonality there often to begin to provide answers. I think it's something we need to do much more systematically. And one of the reasons that, you know, we value our partnership with the OSI in particular is the work that OSI does really to, and I'll use strong language for the benefit of the recording, to expose open washing, open source, you know, and that I think is something which is of critical importance when very time-pressed, cash-strapped higher education decision makers are making choices, because it's very easy to misstep in a choice and land in something which is more or less the equivalent of a commercial proprietary trap.
Can I follow on that?
Please.
I think in the industry space, and we have some nonprofits as well, the edge of full-on commitment, like, well, you do have one department may start and be, you know, maybe it's engineering, maybe it's somebody else that says, oh, we want to do this open source thing, but it doesn't really gain traction until you get commitment from legal and business and engineering, because otherwise you end up, if it's just business and no one's really actually making sure you're doing it, then it turns out like open washing. If it's just engineering, then you have a bunch of code in your repository and, or in your product that your legal department doesn't know about, which is also a very bad situation. But you really need like cooperation from all three departments and an understanding and a shared mission of like, this is what we want our relationship to the community to be. This is what our business model is and what we actually get money for and what we want to monetize. And this is the licensing strategy that matches those goals. You can't do one without the other or do them siloed and separate.
I have a lot more questions for you, but I want to give people in the audience a chance if there are questions. Or are we now in the sugar crash period of the...
Maybe you should ask one more so they can gather their thoughts.
That's a good idea. So while you are gathering your thoughts, I would ask...
Oh, did you want to speak to the last one?
Hmm?
Did
either of you want to speak to
them? I was going to pose a problem that might help.
Yeah.
Spark some conversation, but I didn't mean to.
Go for it.
So, well, here's a contribution problem.
Okay.
That honestly we're confused about. So last week we got, you know, we put out a call. We do it like once a year. You know, can you contribute? And we got an email from a student who had just finished her BA at McGill, and saw the Trello board. Didn't send us her CV because she doesn't have a CV because she's 22 or something, and she took it on herself to write one of the essays that we need, that we needed desperately. And she wrote us an email and attached the essay and said, I know you look for people with PhDs and lots of teaching experience, but I really love smart history and I love what you're doing and I really want to help and I saw you needed this essay and I wrote it and here it is. So now I've got this great essay written by, you know, so I have a problem, right? Because the community won't use smart history unless smart history is written by seasoned academics with teaching experience and PhDs and real expertise. But I've got this great little essay from a student who just finished her BA at McGill, who's a little art history major. So, you know, I can pass it along to our contributing editor and have her look at it. It's an object, it's Islamic, so I can pass. But then I have a co-authorship problem, you know, and I have this trust issue. Art historians are a really tough bunch. They don't want to use the site unless they can really feel like they can trust it 150%.
Mm.
Is that an interesting problem? Maybe it's not so interesting.
Good.
Can you yell into the microphone so we can get this recorded for posterity? Thank you.
Is there an opportunity for co-authorship and second authoring as a BA doesn't have the qualification to be first author? Maybe she could partner with somebody else who's in the art history department and has a PhD at her university? Is that a conversation that you guys have tried to kind of undertake?
Yeah, we've actually tried that before. And often the contributions take a lot of work on our part, much more work than when we just get it from one contributor who has a PhD and 10 years of teaching experience. That's the downside. So we get more stuff that way, but we get stuff that takes more work.
I'm wondering if you could put in your documentation, hey, if you're new, it's going to be hard for us to take your contribution unless you rustle up a co-author for yourself. No. And make them do the work before they give it to you.
The problem is that even when they work with a co-author, the co-author usually has a stake in it because they're their teacher, or they're in some role with them, and they're not as hard on them as we need to be before we publish something. So it still takes a lot more work for us.
So I would say that based on the kind of very narrow scope of what it is that you're trying to do, maybe in the context of some research subjects, it makes sense for you guys to try to go that extra mile, but you have to make your own decision about the rationality.
I agree.
And then,
before I say the thing I came up here to say, I wanted to feedback on that.
I was actually just going to ask you to do that.
Great.
Given your comments on the previous panel, I'd be interested in hearing your thoughts.
So it sounds like you guys, and I understand this will have to be vetted to avoid the fire hose problem, right? But it really sounds like this is a great opportunity to set up a secondary mentoring team, mm-hmm. right? So where, you know, you can establish not that this co-authorship where there's a faculty-student relationship between the type of person who submits that essay, and you know there's a vetting problem, but you know maybe you have a team of in your vast team of contributors already, a small group of folks who are willing to look at things that come over the transom and identify people who are really worthy of mentoring, and then you gotta have a secondary markup for those particular things that this essay was co-mentored, especially since you're looking to reach into non-Western, non-Anglo mm-hmm. art traditions, right? Mm-hmm. Where you've got a way yeah. to really kind of build that positively and still get your persnickety audience to thumb it up.
Yes, that's a great suggestion. Thank you.
I want to hold your question because I want to finish the conversation about this, but I also want to get to your question.
Sure.
Is that all right? Okay, so Ian,
yeah, I mean,
why don't
I just
you...
want to quickly to say that one of our software communities produces some authoring tools. I was at their conference recently, and a very powerful strand that has certainly got prominence in the UK at the moment is this idea of students as content creators. Students using tools to create content to help teach other students. And I just wanted to slot that in because I think as a strand of activity in higher education, that's tremendously powerful in so many different dimensions.
No, I can't do that, nor do I think it's a good idea, honestly. The difference between what an art historian who's been teaching for 10 years on a Hindu temple can write and what a student would write is the difference between, well,
but it's not an either-or question.
Yeah, it kind of is.
No, I'm sorry, that's a disagreement. I think that you can have...
Given my limited resources, it's either-or question.
That's fair comment.
You need a much more intense mentorship.
Yes, which is... that was a good suggestion.
Sort of a TEDx kind of thing that's separately branded. So, Chuck, is this on this topic or a new topic? All
new
right,
topic.
Then I'd like to give this gentleman his chance, and then you'll be up next.
So we've had brief comment and kind of danced around today on this whole Google Oracle thing. And, you know, it does sound like there's some people up there and some people who probably were in the audience who might have wanted to take a swing at where they think this goes and what its impact might be. So it will clearly impact all of us. And I can say it made teaching the business and legal aspects of open source independent study group this semester much more interesting than I wanted it to be. So I'd love to hear from other folks.
Sorry, Deb.
I think that one's yours, Deb.
So we're looking at you, I think.
Well, so it's one of those things where we did something in the free and open source software community for a really long time without documenting it for the outside world so that when it went to court, it was really difficult to explain what was going on. So a lot of free and open source software rests on sort of legal hacks, the most prominent of which is copyleft or using copyright to make stuff available to anyone who encounters it. The place I work, the Open Invention Network, is also sort of a, go get patents, but then put them in this big free-for-all pool, is also a bit of a hack in that way. So we do those things, but we're not legislators or judges. Sometimes we're lawyers, but that doesn't mean that the larger legal system understands what we're doing. Or even if they did understand it, is particularly inclined to honor it because they don't understand why it's important. So I think it's incumbent on us who do understand those issues to explain it so that by the time a collection of citizens are amassed to sit on a jury, they have, it's not the first time they've ever heard of an open source license. And, you know, I guess kind of throw in there some technical literacy, like just having to explain an API as a hamburger menu was, I don't know whose brilliant idea that was, but I think we could do a little better in school and like foster a bit better understanding of how software gets made so that they're not, you know, looking at a friendlies menu and thinking, oh yeah, I totally understand how software gets made. It's like, no, oh it's, yeah, I wish you did. I wish it was that easy, but it's not quite that.
I'm going to just very briefly assert moderator's privilege and make a plea. We need a defensive patent pool in educational software. We've needed it for a long time. We had a crisis within living memory that was very bad and could have turned out a lot worse. We have failed to rally around that, and I hope that we can rally around that at some point soon.
It was always our hope that people would see the model that we created on open source software around Linux and take it and use it in other places. And I'm in the process of trying to talk the open hardware community into building one. Every time I talk to individuals in the semiconductor community, they're super into it. But like as a group, not. But if you have the inkling to do it, I would say do it. It just makes it, it's a huge waste of money to do patent infringement against people that you're gonna collaborate with the next week. It's just, it creates bad will and it's expensive.
The Blackboard patent assertion against Desire to Learn. That Blackboard.
Google it.
So briefly, since I see you waving the hand, asking for more explanation. Basically, Blackboard asserted a patent against Desire to Learn, which is legal speak for saying they sued Desire to Learn for patent infringement. This was one of a number of patents that Blackboard had filed for, so they were in the process of engaging in what I believe is called patent stacking. The essence of the patent, it took a long time to get Blackboard to admit it was this simple, but finally in court they had to admit that the essence of their patent was that you could log into the system and be a teacher in one class and a student in another class. That was what they patented. Had Desire, it was really economically rational for Desire to Learn to cave and just quietly pay a patent license to Blackboard. That is what happens more often than not. We are lucky that Desire to Learn CEO John Baker was irrational in that respect and fought it and won. And there was quite a bit of reputational damage to Blackboard that they're paying for to this day. But it was a long, hard fight. It easily almost went to the Supreme Court. It easily could have gone the other way. And had Blackboard succeeded in asserting that patent, then pretty much anyone who makes an LMS would have to pay a toll and maybe the first of many.
Just for 20 years, though, unless they got a new patent.
Just for 20 years, that's right.
And that was 2006, so we're 10 years in.
Yeah.
We're halfway.
Halfway.
Right.
Halfway. So first a really quick comment about the seeming conflict between open source software and art history. There is a difference between a contribution to open source software that changes a kernel API and one that changes a typographical error. So there is, some things get different levels of vetting. So, but that wasn't the nature of my question.
Yep. Go for it.
Other than the last 10 minutes, all of you on the panel are surprisingly optimistic. Mm. I'm sitting here and going like, optimistic, that's great. And I'm, you know, an open source contributor and an open source person, and I'm kind of optimistic now too. And I kept thinking, wow, what's all this optimism? And then I thought to myself, well, 5 years ago, I wasn't feeling so optimistic. And so what I would kind of ask all of you to do, if, you know, 5 years ago or 4 years ago or whatever, was there a time in the past when you were far less optimistic? And talk a little bit about that feeling and why are you optimistic now? I mean, or maybe you could say, oh, I've always been optimistic, it's been great. Or is there something in general about open that somehow is kind of a swell that we're all kind of like, holy crap, 5 years ago this wasn't as good as it is today, and we're all sort of benefiting. So take us back a little bit in time and then bring us forward.
All right, sure. So I think for those of us that work in small nonprofit organizations that scrap for money all the time, if we're not optimistic, we're crying. So it's strategic, a defense strategy.
Strategic delusions of grandeur.
That's right. But I think that optimistic because it's been getting a lot more attention in a lot of sectors. And so where we still feel like we talk to each other too much, there are other people who understand what we're saying now. And one of the things we say is never underestimate the power of a well-placed quote. We've had people, Nicole was talking about the Obama administration, the Department of Education, talking about open. That is our lunch and our dinner for weeks. We love that. And that just allows us to have more conversations. So optimistic is when we get success, when we have the body of research that says, you know what, we don't need to talk about quality anymore because that's done. Here's the research, go do it, now we're going to talk about this. That fuels our optimism because we have things now that we didn't have 5 years ago. And that makes a huge, huge difference.
Yeah, and I think no one can really accuse me of being optimistic, generally speaking. But I think it is true that I am more optimistic about open in higher education and education than I was 5 years ago in the area of the arts and cultural heritage. And that's because two things. One is the open access movement with images has really, really taken off. When we first started doing this 10 years ago, we were scared of getting sued. And you know, we were just using images and we thought, oh, well, fair use, and we think it's okay. And we talked to the Fair Use Project and it seemed cool, but we were scared. But so many museums have adopted open access for non-commercial projects like the Met and the Getty and, you know, I mean, there are dozens of museums now, and in fact, museums that didn't allow photography are allowed. I mean, it's in the last 2 years, I think there's kind of a flood of openness around images. And I think there's also a kind of crisis around cultural heritage right now, around endangered cultural heritage. If we think about ISIS destroying cultural heritage in Syria, there is a sense of the importance of cultural heritage, of the visual arts, and of raising awareness of it. It just feels a little better to me. I feel like everyone can see that's the direction that we're moving, and even museums that once clung to the idea of selling images, and there still are museums that cling to the $10,000 a year that they make selling images. There is a sense that when you open images, it's actually so much better, and I think there's more and more research to prove that. Just to plug one thing, there's this thing called the Yellow Milkmaid. Has anyone ever heard of the Yellow Milkmaid syndrome? When museums didn't put out their images to be free and open, a lot of bad reproductions surfaced. So for example, the Rijksmuseum in Amsterdam never released their images for many years, and so everyone thought that Vermeer's milkmaid painting, which you may be able to picture in your head, was really yellow, and so, like, very yellow, and so no one bought the postcard in the bookstore because they were like, this isn't what the painting really looks like. It looks like all those really bad reproductions that I can get online when I Google it on a Google image search. And so the idea that releasing images was actually going to help everybody, I think people get now, and they didn't get before. It's a very fun blog, or maybe it's one of those other things. Anyway, Yellow Milkmaid Syndrome.
So when I started 5 years ago and I would talk to developers, they would say, like, oh, we figured we'd deal with legal issues next year. I'm like, oh, that's a terrible idea. That's a stunningly bad idea. And now people, I have much more conversations with people that are like, yeah, so not like should we, but like how do we do this open source thing? And we have in our space like really big traditional software companies coming in and like showing up, and we're like, oh, like I didn't even know you're still in business, but or you know, cool, like come on in. The water is fine. And then you know, so that's like specific in software, but then more generally, and maybe this is because I live in Cambridge, I get people asking me like, how can I open source art preservation? Or how can I open source my database for brain science? Or, you know, like all these different things. Because they're like, oh, you know about that open thing. I want to talk to you about it. And so, you know, we're open sourcing all the things in Cambridge, apparently. So it's, you know, it's gone from like, oh, legal issues, those sound boring and sad. Like, to like, hey, how do we do this? Which is good.
That's great.
Well, I guess the we've already mentioned the point in time when I've felt most pessimistic, and that was actually around 2006. And part of that was for the reason that we've just mentioned, and part of it was because of the huge number of senior people in higher education who I spoke to, who thought that they could put a tick in the box of having done e-learning by acquiring a learning management system, or as we say in the UK, a virtual learning environment. Now, one of the reasons I feel vastly more optimistic now is because the freezing effect of Blackboard being successful in that patent suit went away. I think that the other aspect that makes me feel much more optimistic is what Chuck alluded to at during the last panel. You know, there are major discussions going on now about what the future of learning will look like. Educause have got that horrible acronym, you know, Next Generation Digital Learning Environment, but the horrible acronym actually obscures a great deal more flexibility. But more critically, I was involved at the end of that process slightly, and the number of people in higher education that it engaged and the results it found, I take great confidence from. And I think that Open has got a critical role to play in building that future. But I'm also acutely aware that, you know, the conversations we've had between communities today is only another step on the road. We need to engage far more people. In particular, we need to engage more academic practitioners in helping inform the software that we build.
Last question goes to the organizer.
Yeah. Well, thanks. So just on the last answers that you all gave, it's clear that whether it's open source everything in Cambridge or museums that are accepting openness or institutions and education. So everyone's, last year I think I read more than anywhere ever it was open source is one and so on. And we've talked about throughout the whole
So Patrick's mic cut out in the middle of that, and I'm, for the benefit of the recording, let me just try to summarize a little bit, which is that as open becomes cool, as weird as that is to say, open is becoming cool, or at least a desirable marketing attribute. What do you do as an organization to establish that you're the real deal, that you're authentic, and how does that tie? What practices do you point to as your kind of, I guess, your e-portfolio, your way of certifying that you are practicing good open hygiene. Why don't we start at this end of the table with Ian and work our way that way this time?
Okay, I mean, we encourage as much transparency as possible. We encourage our communities to conduct their business in the open as far as they possibly can. Our incubation process is partly a stepped written process that our incubating projects go through that helps them understand some of that, and partly it's a mentored process, so there's human experience played into that as well. I mean, in terms of some of the other issues you touched on, Pat, I'd actually go back to the theme of partnership. I mean, we are an organization with limited resources. We expect to partner with like-minded organizations that operate in adjacent space, that do some stuff that we don't do. Because if we try and do it all ourselves, we really will be trying to boil the ocean. So I think partnership is an absolutely critical part of that.
Great. Deb?
Yeah, so for us in the free and open source software space, when we, you know, we try to make sure that it's also transparent. That's a huge part of what's going on. And we pay a lot of attention to the way that projects are governed. So if, you know, if some company says, like, oh, we're going to, like, do this opensource.org thing, and we know it's just, like, one company doing it, or that gets a little bit of side eye in our community. It's like, well, you want everyone to work on it, but you're the only one listed. It seems like you just want us to do free work for you as a for-profit company, which is kind of, you know, like they've tried to shortcut the deal. So we've been doing a lot. There's been a lot of conversation about making sure that, you know, we're facilitating community to do the things that they want to do without, like, trying to co-opt them. And so that's a conversation that we've been having in our space a lot. And I think it's probably the key to that is to make sure that the conversation is a two-way conversation. You never want to be like, oh, let's, like, throw 20 volunteers on that. And it's like, you can't throw volunteers. That's not how it works. Like, you can ask, you can cajole, you can offer prizes or even money, but then they're not volunteers, right? But you can't throw them on something. And so if you don't have the pulse of your community and know what they want and why they're there, eventually they're not gonna be there. So so two-way communication.
Great. Beth?
Well, I think for us I just wrote it down, Patrick, because I think we should do a better job at it. So I put it on my to-do list, but showing our openness and being transparent about it. I mean, every it's in the footer that we're an open educational resource with Creative Commons licensing, and every video says that. But I think we could do a better job of it. But I think we have to walk a tight rope. I don't know, I might get my cliches all messed up, but we have to be careful because a lot of faculty could come to the site and say, oh, they're open. That means they're like Wikipedia, and everyone can edit it, and I can't trust this anymore, not understanding what we mean by open. And so I think we have to be careful about that, yeah. Unfortunately.
Very well. Last word.
So yeah, the first thing we do is we put our values and our vision right on the website, very clear. Everything we do is openly licensed. We make sure the license is clear. You noticed in my slide presentation today that all my slides have openly licensed images and are properly attributed. And I reuse slides from Nicole and David Wiley and other people in the open education community. And then at the end of the presentation, I always point that out so that we practice what we're preaching, reuse, modify, get it out there and show that message. And then finally, I think we... in everything that we do in all of our partnerships, we try to emphasize the value of collaboration. And for us, the word open can be appropriated in all kinds of different ways, but it really is in the way that you approach your work and the way that you approach your partnerships that make you, I think, really an open organization.
Well, thank you all for a fabulous ending panel and keeping the energy up at the very end of the day. And thank you all also for muscling through that sugar crash. We really appreciate it. And thank you, Ian.
Speaking of sugar crashes. The reception at 5 o'clock is on the grand hall on the fifth floor.
So get going.
Okay, and now we're all good? Okay, we're all good. Thanks. Go.